Good morning, everyone. And the sun is still shining. So don't forget, we have a busy week coming up. We've got soup lunch, warm space, and we've got baby group. And for Louis, we've got the Ignite, which he really enjoys. Really has a good time up there. He says he doesn't, but he does. But it's really good that we can actually do something for our community. We can help out. I mean, if anyone wants to volunteer, volunteers are always grateful rather than being pushed. If someone walks forward and says, we'll do an evening, it would be really grateful. So pass the word out. Make sure people know that we're here and we're doing things for our community. And also, Thursday morning is food bank. So, and they're in need of carrier bags, not the bags for life, the carrier bags. They've got enough bags for life, but they just want some carrier bags for little bits to go in. So, have a good Sunday. Roger's going to be doing the service, so I'll introduce you to Roger. So, please be nice and listen.
Well, good morning. Very good. You seem to have a lot going on as a church, which is all good to hear. And perhaps later on in the service, we'll pray for your annual meeting and all the other things that are happening, and for our bishop as he comes. So it's good to support everything and make everything go well. So that's the plan. And it's really good to be here this morning. Amborne and I are always pleased to come. So great to join you. I'm actually having a kind of busy week at St. Peter. I came on Thursday and took a funeral, and I think I'm coming back on Wednesday to take the communion. So all in all, I feel I'm a bit resident here. I'm wondering if you could fix up a camp bed in the vestry or something. So it's good to come. So let me just pray as we begin. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the different things that make up the life of a church. But we especially thank you that at the very heart of it, of course, is coming together to worship you, to hear your word, to pray, and to share in communion, all the things that we're going to do this morning. And we pray that we can come with a really open spirit, a really attentive ear, to see if you have a word for us, a call on our lives, or warm our hearts with love for you and love for people. Bless us, Lord, in any way this morning we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's just join in a prayer that I think will come on the screen, which is just a good one to begin with, asking God to really clear out all the clutter from our minds and help us to focus on him. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to go on specifically also to say to the Lord, well, we're not wholehearted for him. We've let him down many times in many ways. But for all that, our desire is to follow. So we ask his forgiveness and his help to go forward again. Let's say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. And may Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent. Have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, over to our band, who are going to lead us in some singing and worship together.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you will take my place. That you will bear my cross. You lay down your life that I will be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing you've done for me.
A great chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into my heart. work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, and I'm forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever.
Grace and your great mercy. We thank you that you made that sacrifice to come and to set us free, Lord Jesus. And as we remember once again the Easter morning resurrection, that you have declared the grave and that yours is well and truly the victory. And we thank you, Lord, for this. Thank you.
Loving kindness as a flood, when the Prince of Life for ransom shed for us his precious blood. Who his love will not remember, who can cease to sing his praise, and he will never be forgotten through a
Sung about some amazing things, really. Amazing grace, living hope, here is love. And these are the things that shine on our path and give us purpose and value in our lives. To know your grace, Lord, that you reach out to us. To know your hope, that we're heading towards our everlasting home. And to know your love, that you care for us and we can respond to you. All fantastic. Pray that these big words won't just be abstractions, but will go round and round in our minds and fill us with a deep sense of how true they are. For Jesus' sake, amen. Let's sit down. We're going to come to our readings from the Bible. Sorry, I haven't caught up with who's doing the readings. Who's on for them? Great. Let's have, first of all, our New Testament reading from one of the letters, and then our Gospel reading following.
First reading is taken from Romans chapter 6, verses 1 to 14. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we also will live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its evil desire. Do not offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer the parts of your body to him as instruments of righteousness. For sin shall not be your master, because you are not under law, but under grace. This is the word of the Lord.
This is a reading from Luke chapter 7, verses 36 to 50. Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him. So he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume. And as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who was touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." Jesus answered him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher," he said. "Two men owed money to a certain money lender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he cancelled the debts of both. Now, which one of them will love me more?" Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt cancelled." "You have judged correctly," Jesus said. Then he turned towards the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I've entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much, but he who has been forgiven little loves little." Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." The other guests began to say amongst themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you both. Let me just pray. Heavenly Father, help me speak wisely and help us all listen out for your voice. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're still in this Easter time of year when the apostles never knew if they would turn a corner and find Jesus coming around the other side. So they had this wonderful period, and we like to get the feel of it as well and keep thinking about Easter for 7 weeks, I suppose, really, until Ascension. And I'm going to speak about Easter today, but I'm not going to speak about it as a historical event, although it was. I'm going to speak about it as a way of life, the Easter way of life. And what this means is, I'm going to speak really from the Romans reading, the first reading that we just heard. But what it means is, you know, in the Bible, often when they're writing about people who are Christians and have turned to follow Jesus, then they're described as being in Christ. That's the way Paul, for example, often he says, in Christ. You're in Christ. Someone who's in Christ is a new creation. And he talks about people being in Christ. And it really means you're sort of part of him. You're caught up in him. You're sharing his life. You're in Christ. A bit like sometimes we say the body of Christ, you know, for those years he had a physical body and walked this earth and used his physical hands and his physical feet. Now he has a kind of corporate body of people all around the world who act as his hands and his feet, if you like, in the world. So we're kind of in Christ because we're each part of the body of Christ. This is some of the language of the Bible. I once heard a preacher who was also a conjurer. He used to do illustrative tricks. So he had two boxes. And the reason is, let me just say, because I think actually often if you hear Christians speaking, they don't so much say we're in Christ. They say more the other way around, Christ's in me. They say, I ask Jesus into my life, sort of Christ's in me. And that's not completely foreign to the Bible either. Paul said, Christ's in me, the hope of glory. Christ in you, I think, the hope of glory. So anyway, it's not completely wrong to put it that way. So this preacher, he had two boxes. And I still don't quite know how he did it, like all good tricks. But in some way, he had one box in each hand. And he put the box on in his right hand inside the box in his left hand. And then separated them again. And then he put the box in his left hand inside the box in his right hand. For some reason, he was able to make both boxes fit inside each other. He must have had some way of slightly squeezing them or something. It was just like one of these tricks. It was clever. But he was trying to say, yes, you know, you can say Jesus is in me. But it's even more biblical probably to say, I am in Christ, I am in him. Because I'm part of his story. And this is how this passage from the Bible that we've just heard from Romans chapter 6 speaks about it, and especially with Jesus dying and rising, it kind of says, if you're a believer, you were there. You were in Christ. You were part of it. And this is what I want to try and explain today. So if you take it from the chapter that we had, Romans chapter 6, maybe if I just read out verses 3 to 5. Don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we've been united with him in this, like this, in his death, we'll certainly be united with him in his resurrection. It's like the process he went through. He went through death into new life, and he's kind of taking us through death into new life along with him. And this is the power of this way of speaking, and it's what I really want to try and explain today. It's like we were there. We are in Christ. We went through the journey through death into resurrection with him. We're incorporated into Christ. This is the kind of way I want us to think today. Baptism, it mentions baptism, and you've got a font which is a reasonable size, and I think if you think about it, if you had a baby that was only in the first week of its life, you could easily baptize that baby by total immersion. You could put it right under the water, even in this font, and bring it out. And that's really what this font was made for. I think they were used to do baptism by total immersion of babies up until a couple of hundred years ago, when they got too squeamish and started just putting a little water on their forehead instead. And they said, well, a little water's just as good. It represents, just like a little bread and wine represents. That's fair enough. But actually, it looks more like burial if you go right under. And of course, churches that only baptize adults, they normally like to do it that way. And Church of England churches, when they're baptizing an adult, they often like to do it that way. And as you go right under, it looks like burial. And as you come out, it looks like resurrection. And this is the kind of language that Paul is speaking about when he says, in your baptism, you were dying and rising. But actually, it's just your whole experience of Jesus, really. Your whole new life in Christ is through death into resurrection. And this is the Easter way of life that I was mentioning at the beginning. So he says, let me just get this clear. He says, we know that our old self... This is verse 6 now. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who's died has been freed from sin. And if we've died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. So what this means to me is, it means being a Christian is like a really new life. It's not just like a bolt-on. Quite often, you know, we bolt extra bits onto our life. like you might retire and take up a hobby, like do more gardening or learn how to do joinery or crocheting or whatever it is. You might sort of bolt an extra aspect onto your life, and that is always nice, really, if you've got a bit of time and you can add an extra element to your life. Obviously, that's all good. And sometimes I think we treat our faith as a kind of bolt-on, because when we become a Christian, obviously a lot doesn't change. We carry on with the same job, same marriage, whatever we, you know, or depending on our circumstances, whatever's in our life, a lot of it will continue the same, no doubt. But and sometimes we think, oh, our faith's just an extra. And this is what our friends and family often think. They think, oh, he's got a bit religious and he goes to church and he's added a few extra things. He seems to be joining some midweek home group that he goes to. He's got like another thing he does as well as his gardening and his joinery and his crocheting. And now he does this extra one as well. He's got like another bolt onto his life. But it's not really what becoming a Christian is all about, as you know. It's not an extra in your life. It's a whole new life. And it's described in this way as dying to an old life, saying that's the end of the old Roger. And now it's a new life. Everything is different. Everything weighs different in the scales. Your values are all different. Things that were important become a bit trivial, but things that you never thought much about become all important to you. Your whole life is reconfigured. When you turn to Christ, is a new life, not just an extra aspect of your life. And this, I think, is what this language means when Paul says to us, you died with Christ. He says, we know that our old self was crucified with him. It's like your old life was hung up on the cross as well. Our old self was crucified with him. And if we've died with Christ, we believe we'll also live with him. So I want to try and explain this a little bit, this whole thing about dying with Christ. And I'm going to tell you a story. I've made up a story, so I hope you won't mind. It's a slightly extended kind of story. In fact, it's in two chapters. I'm going to tell you a bit of it and then later on a bit more. So it's a kind of story, and I think it's a little bit inspired by when I went to visit my son and daughter-in-law who were working in Zambia at the time, a couple of years ago. And we went to the Victoria Falls and sat in a hotel, actually, sort of above the falls. And you're looking right across this tremendously wide river, the Zambezi, to Zimbabwe on the other side. And it's a very fast-flowing river. And just a little way downstream, it thunders down the enormous falls, and there's really no way you could cross the river because I think you'd be swept away. So it's a spectacular place to be, a very beautiful place, of course. So I think I've taken inspiration and I made up this story. So what I want you to imagine is that you live, and you've always lived, and your family and generations, you've all been living on this riverbank, and it is an enormously wide river. And it's fast flowing because only a little way down it plunges over the waterfall and there's no way of crossing the river. And you live on your bank. And it's a bit of a poor place to live because people have been living there and they've sort of deforested everything and cut down too much. And they've really pounded the ground. They've been growing the same crops year after year and, rather overexploiting the ground, and it's not yielding such good crops anymore. And, where there used to be trees with parakeets flying, it seems like nature itself's a little bit on retreat. It's quite a depressing place to live, really. And you're scratching out a living, still planting your crops, but not getting the returns that you'd like to. And with that, everybody that lives in your community has got a bit hard, really, and a bit suspicious, and they're all sort of locking their door and keeping themselves to themselves because they're struggling and they don't want anybody else to come by and maybe, you know, take their crops or something. So everybody's getting a bit suspicious and inward turned in, and it's quite a harsh way of life, if you can imagine this. And also what makes it especially hard is that you can look right across the river, and on the other bank, it looks miles better. The trees are still there, lush and rich, and the grasslands, and you can still see zebras and giraffes coming out of the trees and wandering around, and parakeets flying, and the people, there's people living there now, and they've got villages, and they look much sort of better. The ground looks easier, and everything looks more contented, which only obviously increases your sense of frustration and irritation with your life, because there's no way you can get over anyway. So another interesting thing is, obviously in the place you live, your culture, you've never developed burial when people die, or cremation for that matter, because the most obvious thing is what you do is you take those who've died down to the bank and release them into the river, and they're quickly swept away over the waterfall. And so for that reason, actually, you actually call the river, the name of the river is the River of Death. That's what everybody calls it. And another strange thing is when you look over to the other bank, they don't seem to do that. You never see them doing that. In fact, it looks like they just don't, you know, get old and ill. They just seem to be able to carry on living on their bank. Can't quite work out why. And some people on your bank say it's just like some mirage, some reflection in the water or something on the other bank. It can't really be like that, and it's just some mirage. But you kind of see it. You can see it. And then a funny thing happens where people say there's a man up a few villages up living on our bank, and he's really different to the rest of us. You know, he's confident. He's not sort of defensive and suspicious like the rest of us are. He seems to sort of stride around and take an interest in everybody and find a lot of joy in life. Actually, a couple of people are saying he must have come over from the other bank. But that is a bit hard to believe. But anyway, this chap's around and about. And actually, one time he comes to your village. And he's got an amazing proposition. He says, look, are you a bit fed up with our bank? Your bank. They say yes. You know, I say yes. He says, actually, I can swim over. I'm going to swim over and I'm going to lash onto a rope, and you can lash onto the rope, and I will swim you over to the other bank. Wouldn't that be better? And you say, that sounds ridiculous, rubbish, don't believe it, and I'm too scared to even think about it. And he goes off. But then you get like the worst year ever. There's some kind of crop disease. Everything's getting harder, harder and harder. Eventually he comes by again and you think, yeah, okay, I've got nothing to lose. Have a go. See if you can take me over. And there's a few of you, your cousin and a couple of other neighbors, and you all say yes. And he takes you down to the bank and he lashes you on. And he starts swimming and you start swimming a little bit as well. And he's strong, he's so strong, he didn't quite foresee it. And he heads up at an angle, but you keep being swept downstream, and he keeps on battling on, and you're on this rope lashed with him, and you think for a minute you're going to go over, but he's heading on and up, and eventually he gets you over, and you come out on the other bank. It was a terrible swim, but when you get there, you're amazed by the bird song that you hear, by the people that are streaming out to welcome you, and you made it safe to the other bank. Well, this is chapter one of my story, and I've got a short little chapter two that's coming up in a couple of minutes. But I'll just tell you from chapter one, I think you all know, I'm really talking about Jesus, obviously, and how he can take us through death to new life. And it's interesting, and some Christians, again, if I'm saying about different way people sometimes speak. Some Christians say he died so that we don't have to. But I think Paul's language actually is more, we've got to die. We've all got to die. Death's come into the world. We're not going to avoid that. And death in the New Testament, it's not just, you know, growing old and dying or falling ill and dying. It's not just physical death. It means the whole thing, really. Separation from God. Death, this is like the world of death already in a way, because if you're not in touch with God, who is the source of life, you know, you're already in this world of decay and death. And so, you know, we all must die, of course. But Paul's language is not so much Jesus died so that we don't have to. It's that Jesus died. He jumped into the river of death. He went through the river of death so that we could also die and go through the river of death and come out on the other side. You know, that's his language, really. We can't sort of, you know, we're in this world of decay. It has to be. But the promise is that Jesus is willing to go through death into the new life and take us through. He's able to take us through. And this is what being a Christian really means. So it is about letting go. Of course, there's a bit of letting go when you jumped off your side of the river, when you jumped off your bank and you left your old farm behind and your friends and your family, and you had to let go, but you jumped at that moment and you swam to the best you could and you came out and you got there. And there is a kind of a dying when we become Christians and we let go of a lot, but it's so worth it. This is the language of the Easter way of life and of Romans chapter 6. So we try and lead a very sanitized life, really, in 21st century. And we, you know, we hardly see a dead body, for example. We've got everybody's in hospital and then the undertakers take the body away. And, you know, it's such a sort of sanitized way of life and people don't want to think much about death. But it's still true that the most important thing in life is to be ready to die, because that is the path that we all must tread. But the Christian message is, yes, but go down into the waters of death, but let Jesus swim you through and come out the other side. This language about a river, actually, it's always been around, even in the old ancient Greek stories, you know, across the river and everything. The river Styx, I think they used to call it. And it's always been in Christian thought, often related to the crossing the River Jordan into the Promised Land, like the old hymn, "Guide me, O thou great Redeemer." And that is all about their pilgrims in the desert. It's like it's relating back to when the children of Israel were walking through the desert, trying to get to their Promised Land. "Bread of heaven, feed me now." It's like when the manna fell. "Open the crystal fountain." That's like when the water came from the rock. "Let the fiery, cloudy pillar lead me all my journey through." You know, that's what happened for them in the desert, the cloudy pillar and the fire at night. And then the last verse, so it pictures our lives in terms of the ancient Israelites on that journey out of slavery in Egypt to their Promised Land. And he says, "When I tread the verge of Jordan," you know, it's the river again, "bid my anxious fears subside. Death of death and hell's destruction, land me safe on Canaan's side." So it's the same type of language, really, crossing the river. And Jesus is the only one who can take us through. So let me just come back to a little chapter 2 of my story. So now you're living on the better side. You're on the new bank. But the trouble is, it's quite... you're quite used to a way of life and you can't just throw it off. You know, you're very sort of fixed in your ways. So, for example, everybody else seems to be living pretty sort of communally, really. They help each other on one big farm. But you just can't quite sort of settle to that. You think, I bet they'll rip me off. And you ask if you can cut down some trees and make your own plantation and have your own farm. And everybody's a little bit shocked that you want to do that. Why would you sort of want to make your own little farm and build your own fence around it? And you don't really like the sound of the birds after a bit. It's too much for you, you know. You can't sort of take it. So you're kind of on the far bank, but you've got the attitudes from the old bank, you know. And they're kind of at quite at ease with the river. They sort of just think, oh, the river flows by. But you're a bit fearful of it, like you always were. You always thought, oh, I don't want to be thrown in the river, and I don't want that to be the only way my life can end. And you still haven't sort of got confident about the river. You're still fearful. And they say to you, look, brother, you've got to change your ways, your thinking. It's good to have reached the new bank, the right bank, the better bank. But now you've got to also live the life of the new bank. You see what I mean? And this is, again, I'm just trying to explain the Bible passage. So let me read on now from verse 8 of Romans chapter 6. He says, if we died with Christ, we believe we will also live with him. We know that Christ, since Christ was raised, we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he can't die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. And in the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. And don't let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its evil desires. And what Paul saw when he wrote to the Romans, probably what he'd heard about them or what he saw everywhere with Christians, is that it's all very well saying, I've crossed over, I've joined myself to Jesus, I've made the crossing, I've come through death spiritually, and one day I'll have to physically, to the new bank, to the better world. I'm there, I'm in Christ. But, you know, so often our old attitudes sort of swim over with us and they seem to still spoil our lives and we're still kind of defensive and fearful and faithless, really. We're still sort of living as if we're in the old world. We're living in the new world as if it was the old world. And how sort of disappointing that is. And I think one of the most fantastic verses in the whole Bible, actually, is that verse 11. And the China Inland Mission, which is possibly the boldest and bravest and most exciting missionary society that there's ever been, had this as their motto, Romans chapter 6, verse 11. In the same way, he says, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. He says, think of yourself, or reckon yourself, or count yourself dead to sin. You're not in that old world. You don't have to think that way. You don't have to live like they live over there. You don't have to be on that old bank mentally. Let it all go. Let it all go. Remember and think and count yourself as now you're here. You're in the new bank, the new side, the new world. Live new. Be what you are. The Christian message really for lifestyle is never really try and be what you're not. It's really be what you are. You're a new person. Just be it. Be it. Live it. Think it. Come to terms with it and let it flow. Be what you are. You're new. Be new. And that's the power of this verse, Romans 6, verse 11. Count yourselves dead to sin. That's not you. But alive to God in Christ Jesus. That is you. That's who you are. That's where you are. And this is the Easter way of life. So Easter is an event of 2,000 years ago. It has to be a historical event. That's the most start of it all. But it's also a way of life. And the way of life is don't try and bolt on Christian faith to the rest of your life. Of course, many things don't have to change, job and home and interests and personality. Lots of things won't change when you become a Christian, but your biggest attitudes will. That's the old you that no longer exists. This is the new you. Be it. Live it. Don't think of that. Don't reckon yourself as like somebody that's trying to be a Christian. Think of yourself as somebody that's made the crossing and let it go, let it flow. That is the Easter way of life. I might just close my sermon with a little prayer. Heavenly Father, I think so much, really, we hang on to kind of defensive, fearful, or faithless attitude that really comes from before faith, before being in Christ. It's ridiculous, destructive, disappointing. So, Lord, help us really reckon ourselves as dead to the old life, to the world of sin and death, and alive to you in Christ Jesus, and live the new way with the new values and the new expectations and a new sense of identity. Lord, help me, help each of us individually. Help us say to you, Lord, help us let it all go. and step forward. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus. Let's stand and sing. Standing and speak out our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. He was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let's sit down and we're going to pray together. We're going to pray for this church and then more widely as well. Heavenly Father, we pray for this church and parish of St. Budo, and we really thank you for its life and mission and all that goes on. Each person who makes up this fellowship, all the opportunities through church, through the hall, through the school, and in every wider way too. So Lord, we pray for our church in every respect. We pray for the annual meeting next week and for those who will be elected to serve as church warden or church council member or representatives. We pray that as people hear the report on the year, they can be regained and rebuilt in vision for the year to come as well. We pray for all the tough things that can come in church life, paying our way and maintaining our building and all the safeguarding and tasks that seem to sometimes burden us down. But we pray that there'll still be mental space and energy for the work of the gospel, for outreach to children and young people and adults. We pray for a radical Christian living here, Lord, where people can say that they're really thinking of themselves as dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ. So we pray, Lord, for this church and its well-being and its future and the idea of a new vicar coming when that can happen and a safe progress towards that and a rich and deep future here. And we pray for our bishop as he comes to take the service next week as well. And we thank you for Bishop James, Archdeacon Jane as well. And we really pray for them with this wide-ranging task, taking a concern for many different churches and coping with crises and issues and plans and purposes. And I really pray for them to be able to also have a big faith that they can both use and then share. So Lord, we pray for your church, but we pray for your world as well. We say so many things that sadden us and trouble us in the world, and we pray about some of them. We see in our own country so many debates and thinking, clashes of thinking, from the safety of the child that's still in the womb through to the well-being of children as they grow up and find their identity, through to the provision for work and for study and for adult life, and then the needs of those who become old or weak. And then even this question of whether people should hasten their end. From beginning to end, Lord, we need your wisdom, and then we need our society to turn to your ways so that life is sacred and everything belongs to you, is a gift from you, and we do our best to give it back to you. So keep us from reckless arrogance and thinking that we know better than the everlasting ways. And we pray for the wider world and for peace in the world. In the Ukraine, we hear now of the American government releasing another £60 billion to fight the war, which is maybe a good thing, but it's obviously going to be a tremendous amount of more fighting there. When will it come to some settlement? Needs to eventually. Lord, we pray for them there. We pray for them in Israel, in Gaza, and the West Bank, and in Iran, and the whole Middle East. And again, you know, we see escalation. Maybe just now we can see a little bit of hope that at least the Israel-Iran thing might go a little bit cooler. We pray that can be so. We pray for the hostages still in Gaza. We pray for the families whose homes have been destroyed and have lost multiple children and all these things that have happened that are so sad and so cruel. And we just pray for a world in which each person can sit in their own home, raise their own family, earn their own living in peace and security. We pray that in some way we can build that world gradually, or at least where we can. So we pray, Lord, for everybody who feels threatened and gets defensive. But for ourselves, help us to live in the sunshine of your love and open up our lives to others. So we offer all these prayers, Lord, in the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And let's carry on directly with our communion prayers as well. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. For he is your living word. Through him you've created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born of a woman and to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you've sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us a people for your own possession. And therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood, who on the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom. And with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. So I invite you to come and receive the communion. I think you know, I'll give you the bread. Normally you'll go this way if you want alcohol-free wine, or that way for alcoholic wine. Or if you really don't want to share the common cup at all, just show to me that you want me to just dip the bread instead. And if you really don't want to receive communion at all, please come forward and just show me that you just want me to pray for you individually instead. So that's how we'll do it.
Oh,
worship him alone.
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Let's stand and sing together.
Eyes of fire, his face is light, the first and last, the living one. His name is Jesus, and from his mouth there comes a sound that shakes the earth, that splits the ground. The gift his voice is like to me, the voice of Jesus. And I will sing my songs of love, calling out across the earth, the King has come, the King of love. Troubled minds can know his face, captive hearts can be released. The King has come, the King of love has come. My lover's breath, the sweetest wine, I am his prize and he is mine. How can a sinner know such joy because of Jesus? The wounds of love are in his hands, the price is paid for sinful man. Accepted child, forgiven son, because of Jesus. And I will sing my songs of joy, calling out across the earth, the King has come, the King of love has come. And troubled minds can know his peace, captive hearts can be released. King has come, the King of love has come. That you are welcome here. Before such love, before such grace, I will let the wars come down. And I will sing my songs of love, calling out across the earth, the King has come, the King of love has come. And troubled minds can know his face, captive hearts can be released. The King of songs of love, calling out across the earth, the King has come, the King of love has come. And troubled minds can know his peace, captive hearts can be released. The King has come, the King of love has come. Oh, the King has come, the King of love has come. Yes, the King has come, the King of love has come.
Let me just pray as we come towards the end of our service. Heavenly Father, fantastic really to come and worship you and know that you listen to our prayers and our praises, however weak they are. But also great to then leave church, go out and try and lead these lives for you in the world where we're really letting go of everything else and being the new person that you've made us to be. Help us really get it and live it this week. So So may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.